Good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to the final keynote of the VCCA 2024. I hope I can give you some insights even here at the end of the conference. I'm honored to be invited. I am Lars Bamslev. I work for the Exxon Research Center, which is part of Oticon, the hearing aid manufacturer, and Dement. Let's go on with the show. Hearing aids are fantastic today. They help millions of people every day in their daily life. I'm sure you can see this in your family. I'm sure you can see this in your surroundings. I've worked for 30 years in the field and I've seen great changes. I'm proud to see devices on people when I go in the supermarket, knowing that there's something of me inside there and I really made a difference. That's nice. Technology is moving fast around us these years with smartphones, AI, and what have you. It's really going fast. Hearing aids are delivering real benefits in real situations, in difficult situations, conversations. They do that, for instance, without howling at all anymore. That's not an issue. And there is promising new tech that we are beginning to apply, such as in sensors and in AI. Let's look at the developmental progress in society. Well, there are 20% in the world who suffer from some degree of hearing loss. And that's one fact. Hearing aid development should be driven by trends in society and technology, we see that happening, and be shaped by new insights that we can find in human behavior, hearing loss, and health outcomes. We all know that hearing loss can lead to reduced audibility and intelligibility, that's the basic thing, but that leads then to increased fatigue, social isolation, cognitive decline, and what have you. In our work, we look at the fact that one size does not fit all, not all hearing losses are identical. There are new technologies coming, as I said already, like the AI and the Internet of Things. And now there's also the issue of data privacy we have to pay attention to. The devices are very small, and there are some other important things. They are powerful now. We have sensor technology in the devices. We have deep neural networks. We have rechargeable features, or the devices are rechargeable. We have in-the-ear speaker units delivering sound directly to the ear. And we also have wireless facilities such as Bluetooth low energy audio and Auracast. Let me give you a brief history of hearing aids. So, we used to use our hand for amplification. Then about 1900, we got the ear trumpet that was able to provide acoustic amplification. In 1930, it was the electronic hearing aid with vacuum tubes. Then 1960 with transistors thereabouts. 1996 was the first digital hearing aid. 2007 was the first wirelessly connected hearing aid. And 2020 was the first hearing aid featuring a deep neural network. I'll just give you some examples from my colleague Horst Wanke of what things were like and what they have become. So in 1977, the anti-feedback system was simple such that the volume control on the hearing aid restricted the high frequency gain when you turned it up. That would see the difference between the black and the yellow curve shows this feature, and you can see how this reduces the high frequency gain and hence tries to limit the feedback when you have turned your volume control all the way up. Now it's quite different. Here we have a spectrogram of some vowels, and the bright pattern is feedback occurring. We don't want that. That's very annoying and disturbing. So what we can do now is actually we can sort of chop this into pieces. And that actually means that It's almost gone. The old self-test you used to do with the hearing aid is no longer possible. You would hold the hearing aid in your hand to make sure it was on because it was howling, but you can't do that anymore. Another example are directional microphones. Here you can see an example with the first directional hearing aid. It had one microphone, but the microphone had two ports, and you could then, with a mechanical switch, open or close one port and thereby achieve a directional pattern, as you see to the left. We still have two microphones in the device, but now they are coupled to the DNN that I mentioned before, and they're also being guided by movements of the body and the head, such that James here can follow conversations from both Valentina and Dave. Little bit about hearing loss and hearing aids. Perceptual hearing losses are really the important feature for us here because that's the most common age-related hearing loss. The consequence of a perceptual hearing loss is reduced dynamic range, reduced temporal resolution, and reduced spectral resolution. This all leads to poor speech intelligibility and noise. You can also have reduced spatial resolution and perhaps reduced sensitivity to some of the tricks we want to do in the hearing aids. But for sure, you have a poor speech intelligibility and noise expressed as, say, a 5 to 10 dB hearing loss. Loudness growth, that's really the key in hearing loss compensation. If you look at the curve to the right, you can see how loudness growth for normal hearing, indicated by the circles, and for hearing impaired, indicated by the squares, and you can see the horizontal arrows indicating what gain would be required to restore normal loudness. This is because of the elevated thresholds in the soft region. So we need to amplify soft signals a lot and loud signals not very much. And this has to be done in such a way that we get audibility of soft sounds, we get comfort over the entire loudness range, and we get a decent sound quality. That's the core of the compression system in the hearing aid. The hearing aid is optimized for speech understanding and music, and people use the hearing aids throughout the day to communicate with others and sense the world. I mention this because you see now other devices that are sort of like hearing aids, but always the important thing is that hearing aids have to work all day long. You have to wear them, they have to be discreet and automatic. You should actually forget about them if that's the best situation. These days, connectivity, wireless connectivity, and apps are also an important new feature of hearing aids. The hearing aid will run at roughly 1 milliwatt power consumption. This enables 18 hours a day on rechargeable battery, or a week if it's a replaceable Singer battery. We need less than 10 milliseconds latency from microphone to speaker unit, both for sound quality reasons in an open fitting, and also for synchronization with lip movements. Until now, hearing aids preferably, so far, hearing aids have to be small still, preferably hidden in or behind the ear. And the type that I'm showing here is very popular now. It's a receiver in the ear that's very discreetly sitting behind the ear. One note is that hearing glasses sound like an interesting feature. We would love to place microphones on hearing glasses to get good arrays, but they have not really happened so far. Well, hearing aids, you have high requirements. They have to function every day, all day, in all situations. And the thing is, what can you do in the heat of the moment? People can fine-tune their devices with their smartphones, but don't expect to be able to do that in the middle of a dinner conversation or the movie theater. Through our research, we're beginning to understand the whole user, other aspects than the plain hearing loss, such as cognitive skills, fatigue, intent, what are you actually trying to listen to, and what are the most important environments and use cases we should focus on. This is a very simple block diagram showing the basic signal processing going on in the hearing aid. To the left, you have the two microphones I already mentioned. These are combined in the directionality system to form some kind of beamforming, typically these days combined with the noise reduction. And then this is followed by the basic hearing loss compensation, which is providing gain of soft sounds and compression, meaning less gain for loud sounds, as I already said. The output of this is then fed to the loudspeaker, the receiver in the ear. This whole system provides, for some signals, a lot of gain, and you have to all the time make sure that there's no feedback occurring. So therefore you have the anti-feedback system in the loop, which is trying to cancel with very different means, trying to cancel the feedback. And in the following, I'll give you a few examples of features that, how these features are actually modernized and how they are working these days. I have some examples here in the following. So in order to make compression work right, you want a level estimator that on one hand is fairly stable in a stable situation. I can show you here. You have a situation here going with different signal levels up and down, but there are some stable situations, you can say. And in this case, we want the device per se to be fairly linear and provide the same gain. On the other hand, if you have sudden changes in level, you go to a different room or something happens, in order to preserve the comfort, you want the level to change. And this is what you can see here with the blue curve being a fast estimator that we don't want, because we don't want a very nervous compression, if you will. And the red curve is, you can say, the stabilized version of it. And in stable situations, the gain is then almost linear, and that's preserving the envelope cues in the speech. I'll give you an example here of how directionality and noise reduction could be implemented. You have the sound with the two microphones to the left. This is fairly noisy. You feed it through a filter bank, so this is done in multiple frequency bands. You have the adaptive directional system combining the two microphones. And then you have, after the combination, you have an adaptive post filter that's suppressing gain even further in the bands that are dominated by noise. And as you can see in the picture, this leads to less noise in the output. I mentioned anti-feedback systems already 2024. It detects the risk of feedback now. It's not only if it's occurring, but before it actually happens. It's doing this in 2x28 canals without any audible artifacts. And this altogether provides 16 dB extra gain headroom in the hearing aid. So you are able to provide 16 dB extra gain in an open fitting. And like I said before, the classical self-test of the hearing aid, holding it in your hand to make it howl, is actually no longer possible. Let's look at future opportunities now. And here I will mostly talk about artificial intelligence or deep neural networks, if you will. I apologize for using the two terms intermixing, but that's how it is. So let's look at a potential hearing device and where we could apply deep neural networks. This is a future hearing aid which has a beamformer with multiple microphones. It has an acoustic scene analysis that can separate these different sources. And then the question is, what do you want to hear? Where is your attention? And the idea is, this is controlled by the user through neurofeedback, such as EEG or pupillometry. And then that's selected and amplified to the user. So let's look at different places where this could be applied. We could use DNN for the basic separation of the different sources. We can use DNNs for noise reduction, speech enhancement, and for hearing loss compensation, so further down in the signal processing chain. We can use DNN to process the brain signals and make a meaningful interpretation. We can use DNN for sound environment classification if we want to do that. We can use DNN for optimization of settings from large data sets. This is a somewhat different application. We can use DNN for synthesizing speech if we want to do that. And we can use DNN for speech recognition. These two last applications are already known out there, but they could also be applied even more in hearing aids. Let's look at the first example. That's using deep neural networks for noise reduction and enhancement. And this is actually what has been done already in the Oticon More device. How do you do that? Well, you train the DNN to be a better post filter, the post filter that I mentioned before, for real scenarios. So it's not, the post filter is no longer guided by amplification rules and things we have designed, but rather it's being taught. And the way it's being taught is that you have a clean target sound, and then you have the noisy sound that comes through the hearing normally. And you train the network to apply gains in the post filter such that the processed noisy sound is as equal to the target sound as possible. This actually creates meaningful noise reduction, and it has the interesting effect that you can actually get cross interactions between different frequency channels, which is not possible in the traditional design, which is channel by channel. Here you can have low frequency energy affecting high frequency gains and vice versa. The small network that I just mentioned could be in a hearing aid or can be in a hearing aid today. We know that. Larger networks can be used for voice separation. And now I'm referring to a project that we have been running with Tampa University, trying to separate different sources. In this particular case, we separated two voices on top of each other. So we have two voices. We extract a spectrogram of this mixture, and we feed that to a deep neural network, where the deep neural network estimates a mask, that's illustrated by the sieve here, and the other one is the inverse. And then that mask decides which element in the spectrogram should go to either be assigned to source one or source two. And this way we can separate two sentences. And we can do that with a delay of 8 milliseconds, which is critical in hearing aid application, as I already said. Here you can see an example of a ratio mask, a number between 0 and 1 in the spectrogram. In the top row, you have the ideal ratio mask, so that's the ground truth, if you will, separating speaker F2 from a mixture of speakers F2 and F3. And in the bottom picture, you have a plot of the estimated ratio mask coming out of the deep neural network. And you can see this is by far the same, but it's identical enough to actually create a benefit. And the benefit of the speech segregation is shown here. You have the word score from the result. The two outputs of the network are presented to the 2 ears, as indicated by the blue and red arrows. And the word score for repeating either of the two sentences that are played is shown to the left. So the sum signal is right around 50%. And then you have three deep neural net conditions, which are different architectures. And then you have the separate. The separate is just playing the two signals to the 2 ears, which is then the golden standard, the best you can possibly do. And what you see here with one network architecture, the LSTM, is you get a 13 percentage point increase in the word score. So you have to imagine two sentences being played at the same time, and then you have to repeat one of them after you heard both sentences based on a keyword cue for the last word of the sentence. So this solution could be done without having any guiding or selecting of the output. If you select one output, the picture is even more dramatic. That means you would have a smartphone or an eye gaze or something that would select the output, one of the two outputs from the algorithm. And here you see that the word score for the sum is below 60, and For taking one of them, it's almost perfect. You are 95%, which is equal to 37 percentage point increase. So that's a huge reduction. I do want to say that this is for a mixture of two voices inquired, which means that there's actually a lot of glimpsing opportunities in the spectrogram. Adding noise would make this problem harder. And a new idea that we have pursued lately with my PhD student Peter Asbjørn Lea-Bysted. That's actually a separate, that was a separate presentation here at VCCA. I hope you attended it, otherwise go back and find it. This is using DNN for hearing loss compensation, which is a pretty wild idea. The idea is that you use two versions of an auditory model to train a neural network, which is then the hearing aid, if you will, or the hearing loss compensation. So in the top row, you have a normal auditory model with normal hearing, giving you some kind of internal representation shown in the plot here. In this case, it's the auditory nerve firing rate that's being output from the healthy auditory model. And in the bottom row, you have the output from an impaired auditory model. This will obviously be degraded, and not as what you see in the picture here. It will be degraded due to the hearing loss. And in front of the impaired model, you have the deep neural network compensation, which is essentially a hearing aid. And you try to train this compensation to make the two output representations as similar as you possibly can. This sounds easy and trivial, but it is not. However, we have been successful in doing this for a large range of signal levels, signal types, and importantly, different audiograms. This is the DNN-based hearing loss compensation. You could also expand this idea and use noise reduction, add noise reduction as well. So in this case, we have added noise to the impaired branch only. That means we are now training the compensation system to try to make the impaired noisy version as similar to the normal hearing clean version as we possibly can. And there's also a benefit in that. And finally, there is a somewhat different application of deep neural networks. This is about collecting settings and user preferences in real life and collecting these to the cloud. For many users, for many days, you get a very large amount of data, and you can use AI / DNNs to optimize the settings, both for the individual, but also for the population. And these are techniques we already see and use today. Let's look a little bit about how we work when we develop features. To the left is the traditional rule-based approach. We have filters, we have frequencies, we are programming algorithms, and we need a lot of technical insight to solve the task, to design and implement the algorithm correctly. So the right, we're using artificial intelligence or deep neural networks, if you will. There, it's a matter of having the skills to choose the proper encoder, choosing the proper features, choosing the proper training algorithms, and the right evaluation criteria, also known as a loss function. There is still knowledge that needs to go into that in order to get a satisfactory result. And there is no free lunch. We don't have infinite power in the hearing aid, and we want the best performance we can get. So on the one side, you have things like the size of the deep neural network, the topology, and the available processing power you have available. On the other side, you want good performance. You want to be able to generalize towards unknown voices, unknown noises. You want the best sound quality, and you want the best speech intelligibility. So there are some trade-offs to be made here. And at the moment, there is definitely a limit to how big networks we can fit into devices. So what is it, these deep neural networks that we're talking about? Is it AI or is it hype? I would say the way we have been applying them so far, they are actually dumb machines, and that's perfectly fine. Nevertheless, these dumb machines have already outperformed traditional solutions when it comes to, for instance, speaker separation. It's still a black box. That's a disadvantage. It's hard to understand what's going on and which features are important. And the machine is never better than the training examples you have chosen. So you might ask, why is it not happening quicker? Because we haven't seen so many groundbreaking benefits or really strong benefits with deep neural networks. And I would say their generalization is truly a challenge. I hinted at it before, but a hearing aid will be exposed to many different noises and it has to tackle them all. And that's where the generalization comes in. And then it has to be able to, in principle, adapt to the user so that different voices are enhanced over time, say family members and others. And all of these benefits have to be documented. We have to show that there is a clinical benefit from the algorithm, and that's not easy either. We can often see that when we go from the lab to the real world, that's when we lose the benefit we already had shown. So there's a way ahead there. And like I said, we still have limited computation power in the device, and that's something we have to live with. That's getting better over time, so that's good. Let's look at another future opportunity, which is intent decoding. In this case, we want to try to find out what is the intent of the user, what am I attending to at the moment. And we could perhaps use DNNs here for processing the brain signals or the eye signals to try to get at the intent of the user. So the sensor technology, electrodes, accelerometers, etc., can actually provide us information about what the user wants, and we can try to do that in natural scenes where you're doing normal dialogues and understand the environment that the user is in and use that to perform the best possible signal processing in the moment. I have two examples here. One is a bit of future music, but there is a study already that shows that when you have two speech sources, you have two speech streams presenting to the two ears, you can ask the user to attend one and ignore one, and you can actually read that in the EEG. The EEG from the scalp will be correlated to the speech signal that the user is attending to. So we could use that information. Of course, we need to bring the electrodes from this hat that no one wants to wear to electrodes in the ear canals, and that's a challenge in itself. We could also look at eye gaze. It turns out from our experiments we've seen that ear EEG can actually be used to decode the eye gaze because the eye is an electrical dipole. So the electrode can detect which way you're looking, and we can use that together with inertial sensors to find out where is the user attending to. And then we can use that to control the output of the neural network that I talked about before and select the proper signal to the user. So let's wrap it up. Hearing aids are fantastic already today. And when we're talking about deep neural networks, they are already used in hearing aids. To provide better sound quality and to provide better benefits in noise. But they have further potential, and they will get bigger as the hardware becomes more capable. I think there are some major challenges in generalizing to different noise signals and different situations. And then there is, of course, the computation power and the power consumption that we need to be aware of. Important take-home messages when we think about making these advanced features is that from our early research, which is of course is where you start, if this has to become features in real products, it has to work in real life. It has to be fast and it has to be reliable. You cannot have a spatial filter acting 5 seconds after you change your eye gaze, something like that, or doing it in a random or not meaningful way. That's not gonna help the user. So it has to be fast and it has to be reliable. So I would say in our field there is a lot of hype, and we need to benefit from that. We need to be inspired by that, but we should also keep our feet on the ground and consider what do we think is realistic in a wearable device. And finally, just a reminder, even with artificial intelligence or deep neural networks, we still have to think. So with those words, I thank you for your attention, and I'm looking forward to questions you might have. Thank you.